Hi, my dear pathology buddies. Very nice to see you all again through this video. Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, as usual, depending upon the time you are seeing this video. This time I thought I will just go through the basic points and GIT lesion, how to approach. Predominantly, it covers GIT biopsies. Again, it's more morphology based. I may not be talking much of molecular. Before going into the exact GIT approach, I want to know who is your boss. You answer by yourself. And I think this I asked even in my previous video. So you are your boss, yourself. This is the answer I want to hear from everybody. This is very essential to have a very high self-esteem. And if you know that you are your boss, life will become very happy. The next question, who is our boss? You are your boss, but who is our boss? Our boss means people like you and me and people who are involved in the healthcare delivery. The patient is our boss. That understanding also very, very essential. So the patient meets the clinicians first. They come with complaints and tell the same thing to the clinicians. The clinicians do a physical examination after getting their thorough clinical history. They write lab and radiological investigations. They have their own provisional diagnosis. Since we are dealing with the GIT in this presentation, probably they may go for endoscopy and biopsy. The radiologists give a radiological diagnosis, and the pathologists, we after getting the biopsy, we give a pathologic diagnosis. So the end point is the patient is having three diagnoses now: clinical, radiological, and pathological diagnosis. It has to be correlated to come to a final diagnosis. All the clinical, radiological, and the pathological findings should be focused into a final diagnosis. And then treatment should start on the final diagnosis. And the patient has to respond to the treatment. This is the most important thing. If the patient is not responding to treatment, then whatever we do, it's not going to serve the purpose. Only when the patient responds to treatment, the patient will become happy. And when the patients are happy, all the three people involved, clinicians, radiologists, and the pathologists, can be happy. This is very necessary to understand the psychology of a medical care team. Our boss is patient. And patient should be happy by the way of responding to the treatment. Then only our diagnosis is correct. You may give a correct diagnosis, clinical, radiological, pathological, all of them may give a diagnosis. But if there is no response to the treatment for that diagnosis, again, it is not serving the purpose. So the bottom line is we are our own boss. Our patient is our collective boss. And we have to keep a happy patient by the response to treatment. Specimen, this is what we get in the lab. And you have to remember, behind each specimen, there is a patient. This is very, very essential. And as a pathologist, from the time of training, you have to remember the difficulties in getting the specimen. What we do in our hospital, we do 2 days posting for all the first year PGs in all procedural areas. For example, in endoscopy, colposcopy, bronchoscopy, every procedural area, we post them for 2 days. In these 2 days of posting, they will know and they will see by their eyes the difficulties the patient is undergoing in the way of getting the specimen. So this personal experience is very, very essential. Another thing you have to remember, it is our privilege to serve the patient. Healthcare is the only profession where we deal with sick people, and we have to take it as a privilege. And our patients deserve more. That is another essential thing. We have to serve our patient in always a better way. I will give you some beautiful references. And then we will go to introduction, where we remember all the concepts. This knowing the concepts is very, very essential before interpreting the biopsies. Then we will go organ by organ. We will go from esophagus, move on to stomach, then into small intestine. Appendicular lesions we will be seeing. After that, large intestine and anal canal. So we will be covering each organ of the GI tract after knowing the basic concepts of how to interpret a lesion. Then, as usual, we will end it with a conclusion. So the references I want to tell, first one is by my friend Amitabh Srivastava. He is in Brigham Women's Hospital, Boston. He had given a nice presentation of algorithmic approach to interpretation of tubal gut biopsies. So this, that will be the primary reference. And the secondary references are from Twitter, from great people like Dr. Elizabeth Montgomery, Dr. Christine Arnold, and Dr. Raul S. Gonzalez. You can see their videos. If you just type in their name in the YouTube, you may get the videos of their teaching. I strongly urge you to go through their videos so that you will get a more broader knowledge. And I have given the Twitter handles of these three people. Please follow them to learn more GI tract. And in addition to your standard textbooks, either Ackerman or Sternberg, pathologyoutlines.com is another good website where a systematic approach is given for all the conditions. So these are all my references. Any organ, before knowing the pathology, you must know the normal histology. When you know the normal, then it's very easy to understand the abnormal. So let us start with the histology. In the GI tract, it can be a resection specimen or it can be a biopsy. One basic thing you have to understand is, in biopsies, they want the diagnosis. Whereas in the resection specimen, they want the factors that contribute to prognosis and the theranosis. The diagnosis is predominantly in the biopsies, but this paradigm is slightly shifting. Even in the biopsies, nowadays they want to know more of prognostic and theranostic factors, but diagnosis is the number one in biopsies. That you have to remember. Always think of luminal space in any specimen you are getting it. After that, in the resection specimen, there are these three layers: mucosa, submucosa, muscularis propria, serosa or adventitia, depending upon organ we are talking in the GIT. These are all the four layers of the gut tubular organ. In the biopsies, in the mucosa itself, you have to see the surface epithelium, subepithelial glands, lamina propria, and the muscularis mucosa. So this is the basic difference between the resection and the biopsy, because the normal histology, what you are seeing, is slightly different. You have to pay more attention in cases of biopsies. So let us see the normal histology. This is the luminal surface, and these are all the crypts arranged in like a test tube fashion. Please remember the uniform size, uniform shape, and the uniform distribution. I always mention size, shape, distribution. SSD. Okay. It has to be uniform. And see here, all these crypts are gently sitting on the muscularis mucosa. So this is the surface epithelium. These are all the glands cut longitudinally, and when they cut tangentially, you may get the glands. Otherwise, you see the crypts, and these crypts are held in place by the lamina propria. Lamina propria is the stroma of the mucosa that supports the epithelium. And these glands are resting on the muscularis mucosa. And below that muscularis mucosa is the submucosa. And below that is the muscularis propria, the inner circular layer, neuroenteric plexus, and then outer longitudinal layer. And outside is the serosa in cases of colon. So these are all the four layers of the gut. Mucosa, submucosa, muscularis and serosa. In the mucosa itself, surface epithelium, subepithelial glands, lamina propria and muscularis mucosa. This understanding is very, very essential, because even though each gland is having the basement membrane, to call it as an invasive carcinoma, the malignant gland should cross the muscularis mucosa. The muscularis mucosa, in fact, acts like a basement membrane, even though it is not the basement membrane. Only when the neoplastic process are crossing the muscularis mucosa, we call it malignant, because the minute they cross the muscularis mucosa, they come into the submucosa, where you see varying sized blood vessels through which they can go into lymphatics. So that is very essential to keep it in your mind. The muscularis mucosa is similar to basement membrane in the other organs. Then you may ask me, what happens if you see neoplastic glands in the lamina propria? There are two terminologies used. In USA, they call it high-grade dysplasia. Whatever is happening above the muscularis mucosa, it is called high-grade dysplasia. Whereas in Europe and other Western countries, they call it as intramucosal carcinoma. If you see a malignant gland in the lamina propria breaching the basement membrane of the gland, then it is called as intramucosal carcinoma. Why in US they don't want to call it as intramucosal carcinoma? The minute you say carcinoma, that carries a bad prognosis because of the regional and systemic metastasis. But the incidence of metastasis in an intramucosal lesion or lesion in the lamina propria going as a metastasis is very, very less. That's why they don't want to wrongly call it as carcinoma and want to call it as high-grade dysplasia. I agree with the terminology of high-grade dysplasia, but you have to remember it can be interpreted as intramucosal carcinoma also, when it is confined within the lamina propria above the muscularis mucosa. Another thing you have to keep it in mind is you can see a lot of lymphocytes and plasma cells. You should not call it as inflammatory cells. For example, we are all having a total WBC count of 4 to 11,000. They are all in the blood vessels. Since they are in blood vessel, will you call it as vasculitis? No, you cannot call it as vasculitis. That's what happening in the lamina propria. It is rich network of capillaries. And within the capillaries, you see the WBCs, predominantly lymphocytes and plasma cells. So you should not call it colitis the minute you see lymphocytes and plasma cells in the lamina propria. That is another very essential point you have to understand from normal histology. And when you see plasma cells, I will be asking, what is the role of plasma cells? It is the secretion of IgA into the lumen. So the plasma cells will be more in the top of the mucosa. As you go down, the number of inflammatory cells, sorry, I should not call it as inflammatory cells. The number of plasma cells and lymphocytes will be less, and there is no plasma cells or lymphocytes sitting in the bottom of the glands, in between the glands and the muscularis mucosa. So in normal, you see more of lymphocytes and plasma cells in the top. So it is otherwise known as top heavy. Whenever there is an inflammation, we will be seeing it again. But I want to introduce the term bottom heavy. When you see more plasma cells and lymphocytes deep down in the lamina propria, sitting in between the base of the crypts and the muscularis mucosa, then it is known as bottom heavy. That bottom heavy plasma cells and lymphocytes are more diagnostic of chronic colitis. So I think these are all the very essential points you have to know in histology. Again, always keep a note of what is happening in the lumen. Probably in resection, it is not important, but in case of biopsies, you may see some bugs, unwanted gus sitting on the luminal surface of the epithelium or in the lumen. So always watch what is happening in the luminal space, especially in cases of biopsies. These are all the three points you have to remember: uniform size shape distribution of the glands, top heavy plasma cells and lymphocytes in normal, and these glands will be sitting on the muscularis mucosa. Super. Now let us go to the highest power. And another point you can note in the highest power is, this is the lumen, this is the surface epithelium. The surface epithelium is always single layered. That is another very important thing you have to remember. Sometimes because of tangential cut, you can see one or two layers of cells, but in a normally oriented biopsy or resection specimen, the surface epithelium is single layered. And when you go to high power, there are four lines you can appreciate. Number one is the top of the, this is the mucin, top of the mucin. These are all mucin. This is the cytoplasm and this is the nucleus. And number line, the imaginary line you can draw here, is the top of the mucin vacuole. Number two is the bottom of the mucin vacuole. Number three is the cytoplasm. And number four is the nuclei. So they are arranged in four layers, the surface epithelium. Why this is important? In cases of dysplasia, this normal pattern will be disturbed. Especially, this is very useful whenever you are assessing esophageal mucosa for Barrett's to see whether there is dysplasia or not. You can see a very ugly nucleus, but when you see these four layers, then that ugly nucleus may be due to reactive, regenerative, or treatment-related changes. It is not dysplasia. The minute the four layers are maintained, dysplasia is ruled out. So this is another section from gastric cardia or antrum. Because I don't see any parietal cells, that's why we have to call it as gastric cardia or antrum. And these are the surface epithelium, and these are the subepithelial glands. And here you can see the architectural change. They are not uniformly sized, shaped, or distributed. So you have to assess, the next step in normal histology is, first you have to assess the architecture. Then you have to go to the cytology. In the architecture, in the normal, it is uniform size, shape, distribution. And these glands are sitting on the muscularis mucosa. You may not be able to see any lamina propria normally because these glands will be uniformly distributed. The minute you see visible lamina propria, that means some glandular dropout or atrophy that you have to remember. Another thing in biopsies you have to remember is, it is mainly sampling the mucosa and maybe superficial part of the submucosa. It is not sampling the deeper submucosa and beyond. The minute you see serosa or fat in biopsy, it is a panic value. You have to immediately call the physician who did the procedure because they might have perforated the colon or stomach. And as I told, you can see scattered lymphocytes and plasma cells in the lamina propria, and it is not equal to inflammation. When do you call inflammation? Again, as you know, inflammation is either acute or chronic. In acute inflammation, you see ulceration with the exudation. This exudation is very important because in sometimes the mucosa may be sloughed off, it may look like ulcer, but you have to see the exudation. Number two, you have to see the neutrophils or lymphocytes or eosinophils sitting on the epithelium in the colon, we call cryptitis. The epithelium is infiltrated by the WBC. WBC is sitting on the epithelium is cryptitis. The third point is the neutrophils or other WBCs sitting in the lumen. It is known as crypt abscess. So you should know what is the criteria for cryptitis and what is the criteria for crypt abscess. Neutrophil sitting on the epithelium is cryptitis. Neutrophil transpassing the epithelium and sitting in the lumen is crypt abscess. Or when you see WBCs 5 or more in one focus, then you are eligible to call it as acute inflammation. When do you see chronic? What do you mean by chronic? Chronic means roughly 6 months, patient is having on and off symptoms. What happens at that time? There is some ulceration, some granulation tissue, then regrowth, then ulceration. So repeated ulceration and regeneration that leads to architectural disarray. So architectural disarray is very important to diagnose a chronic inflammation either in the stomach or small intestine or in the colon. And how do you identify architectural disarray? Variation in the size, shape, and distribution of the glands. The second criteria is basal plasmacytosis. As I told you, normal it is top heavy. When the plasma cells are more in the bottom, then it is known as basal plasmacytosis. And when it goes in the basal area, sometimes the plasma cells will go and sit in between the crypts and the muscularis mucosa. It's part of the basal plasmacytosis, indicates chronic inflammation. Number three, lymphoid aggregates in the stomach. Lymphoid aggregates in the ileum is normal. Right colon is all right. But you cannot or you should not see lymphoid aggregate in the stomach. If you see lymphoid aggregate in the stomach, it's a chronicity and it indicates H. pylori predominantly. And another criteria when you call chronic inflammation is when you see granulomas. So these are all the four criteria for chronic inflammation. In some conditions, you have specific criteria. For example, when do you call lymphocytic gastroenteritis? When you have more than 25 cell lymphocytes per 100 epithelial cell, count 100 epithelial cells, and if you see lymphocytes sitting on the epithelial cells more than 25, then it is lymphocytic gastroenteritis. When you see eosinophils, 15 eosinophils per high power field, it is not 100 epithelial, per high power field, or 5 eosinophils sitting in one focus, that is a criteria for eosinophilic gastroenteritis. I am giving all the criteria. That's why we are seeing more and more of letters. We will be seeing the pictures after finishing the criteria. This table is very important to understand the concept of dysplasia. As I told you, in normal, it is single layer of epithelial cells lining the glands and on the surface. The polarity is maintained. I mentioned what is polarity in the previous video. You draw lines all along the long axis of the cells, and if all the lines are parallel to each other, that means the polarity is maintained. When the long nuclei are running in different directions, if the lines drawn along the long axis of the nuclei are crisscrossing, then it is loss of polarity. Cribriforming forming and micropapillary, you don't see it in normal. In normal, you see the nucleus in the basal layer. Mucin is present. Nucleoli is very inconspicuous. Normal surface epithelium, you should not see mitosis or apoptosis. You may see it in the proliferative crypts, in the neck of the crypts, but you should not see it on the surface. So single layer with maintained polarity, basal nuclei with abundant mucin, inconspicuous nucleoli without mitosis and apoptosis are the characters of the normal epithelium. In dysplasia, it gets stratified. Single layer becomes stratified. And what will happen when it is stratified? The mucin will become less or absent. Okay, stratified cells with less or absent mucin, and these are the two main characters. And the other thing is mitosis and apoptosis. So there are four main criteria for dysplasia: stratified cells, absence of mucin, presence of mitosis and apoptosis even on the surface. When you see these four, it is dysplasia. Then how will you differentiate low-grade dysplasia and high-grade dysplasia? In low-grade dysplasia, the polarity is maintained and the nuclei are occupying up to middle one-third. Cribri forming or micropapillary formation not present, and macronucleoli not present. You will understand more the minute you see the pictures. Just keep these things in your mind. In high-grade dysplasia, again, the cells are stratified. The polarity is lost. There is cribri forming and micropapillary formation. Nuclei reaches the upper third of the epithelium, or they are touching the apical membrane of the cells. Mucin is absent. Macronucleoli, they start coming in high-grade dysplasia. Again, mitosis and apoptosis will be present. So this table gives you a nice differentiation of normal from low-grade dysplasia and high-grade dysplasia. And this dysplasia should be seen involving the surface epithelium when the surface epithelium is intact. If the surface epithelium is ulcerated, you get a depurse, or it has to go up to the top. If you see these changes only in the base of the crypt, it is not qualified to call it as dysplasia. So those are all the basic concepts. Now let us switch gears and go and see how to approach, how to apply whatever we learned. You all should be knowing the whole pathology is now done with pattern analysis. This pattern analysis is also very important to put semi-objective criteria so that in future artificial intelligence will take care of the diagnosis. So in any lesion, you have to ask these four basic questions. Is there any proliferation? Is there any atypia? Is there any invasion? Is there any metastasis? These are all the four questions you have to answer. And depending upon the answer, you get the probabilities. When you ask, is it a proliferative? It can be a non-proliferative disease or proliferative disease. Whenever there is proliferation, you ask, is there any atypia? So proliferative disease may be without atypia or with atypia. Whenever there is atypia, ask for invasion. So the lesions can be non-invasion or invasive. The non-invasive can be pre-neoplastic or dysplastic. And then in the invasive, it can be micro-invasive carcinoma or invasive carcinoma. And in case of carcinoma, then you ask the question of metastasis. Present or not present. When it is present, whether it is in the lymph node or in the systemic. These are all the patterns by which you have to classify the disease. Let us see examples for these patterns. Non-proliferative disease, the best example is diverticulosis, where the normal mucosa is going through the muscularis mucosa and submucosa because of the increased intraluminal pressure. Proliferative disease without atypia can be proliferation of the internal cell components of the gut, or externally cells are coming into the gut. The internal is hyperplastic polyp and leiomyoma. The external is more like infection, CMV, tuberculosis, where you see a lot of inflammatory cells forming granulomas or virus particles. In the pre-neoplastic, it is Barrett's esophagitis. The example of dysplastic lesion is the low-grade and high-grade of adenomas. So these are all the pattern analysis. Again, four questions: proliferation, atypia, invasion, metastasis. When you don't see the lesion, what will you do? Do you identify who is this person? It's classic. Even with the small piece you can give, it is our father of our nation, Mahatma Gandhi. So let us see another example. Who is this? Don't know. Go deeper. go to the next level, and the full lesion, sorry, full person is seen. It is Deepika Padukone. So when you don't see the lesion, always go for deepers. And always call the clinician if you don't see it in deepers. For example, they are taking a gastric biopsy for CA, stomach. You don't see it. Go for deepers. And even if you don't see that, call the clinician and find out. Is there a growth? Is there only ulcer? Is the radiology looks like a linitis plastica? For example, if it is linitis plastica, we have to look more carefully for signal cells. So any difficult situation, you please call the clinicians. The best instrument that helps you in difficulty is the mobile phone. Luckily, everybody is carrying a mobile phone now. Just give them a call, and that call will relieve you of all the problems. So that's the end of the concepts. If you don't understand any of the concepts, please see the video again, or you just drop it in the comment area. I will get back to you.